Good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 18th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2024. We have apologies this morning from Colin Beattie. The first item on our agenda is for the committee to consider whether or not to take agenda items 3, 4 and 5 in private. Are we content to do that? We are agreed. Thank you very much. And our major item for consideration this morning is a look into how expiring private finance initiative contracts are dealt with, which is something the committee's delved into over the last few months. And I'm very pleased that we've got a lineup of people who will hopefully shed some light on that whole process and how it's working and how it might work in the future. So I'm very pleased to welcome the Director General of Education and Justice in the Scottish Government, Neil Rennick. Also Peter Reakey, who's the Chief Executive of the Scottish Futures Trust. Kerry Alexander is here as well, also from the Scottish Futures Trust. Theresa Medhurst, who's the Chief Executive of the Scottish Prison Service. Good morning. And we're also joined by Lorraine Rugan from HMP Kilmarnock, from the project executive there, and by Adam Jobson, who's the Director of Organisational Development in the Scottish Prison Service. So you are very welcome. We have got quite a number of questions to put to you this morning. But before we get to those, I would like to invite, first of all, Neil Rennick and then Theresa Medhurst to make some brief opening remarks. So, Director General, over to you.
Thank you, Convener. I welcome the Auditor General's paper on investing in Scotland's infrastructure. The paper is right to highlight the expiring privately financed contracts in Scotland and the importance of individual public bodies assessing and preparing for the impact of this. Given the number of privately financed contracts coming to an end in the next few years, this is a very timely discussion. HMP Kilmarnock was the first privately financed and run prison to move into the public sector in March this year, when the contract signed back in 1997 came to an end. I commend Theresa Medhurst and her colleagues for all of the planning, preparation and engagement that took place ahead of the transfer and for the ongoing process to bring HMP Kilmarnock and its staff fully into SPS operations, which I'm sure the committee will explore. A number of PFI contracts within education and justice interests are due to end by 2030. Each PFI contract is different, and it is the responsibility of the individual public body to manage the contract and to plan and prepare for the end of the contract. In general, the Scottish Government is not involved directly in that process. However, there are consistent lessons to be learned and applied by bodies managing this process, and I'm grateful for the guidance and support that the Scottish Futures Trust provide to help public bodies prepare for the expiry of PFI contracts. I'm reassured that those bodies with contracts closest to ending are engaging with that process to consider the financial and practical implications, and I'm happy to answer any questions the committee has on those issues.
Thank you. Theresa Medhurst.
Good morning, Convener and members of the committee. My colleagues and I are very grateful for the opportunity to meet with you today to discuss from an operational perspective HMP Kilmarnock moving to SPS and the public sector prison estate from a design, construction, management and finance PFI contract. I also welcome the Auditor General's comments and appreciate the areas highlighted, namely the steps taken to prepare for the transition of HMP Kilmarnock and the lessons learned that can be shared with other public bodies who are currently preparing for the end of a PFI contract within the Director General Education and Justice portfolio. What I would like to say is that on Sunday the 17th of March, I marked the successful transfer of HMP Kilmarnock to SPS management after careful transition planning through a project structure. I know personally that the prison is safe, secure and well run with strong links to its community. I'm also aware that there are likely to be many areas of good practice at Kilmarnock which we now look forward to learning from, as well as sharing with Kilmarnock the good practice in other public sector prisons. We are continuing to work on a phased approach to bring Kilmarnock into SPS fully as a public sector prison, including welcoming staff to the SPS and ensuring that the operating model continues to develop. We are also taking steps to enhance working conditions for staff and develop services for those people in our care. The success of HMP Kilmarnock transferring is as a result of the positive and continuous engagement we had with KPSL and Serco, and particularly Serco staff on site in Kilmarnock, from the very commencement of the project, and this work continues post-transition. We understand the importance of lessons learned and will endeavour to share our experiences to date on the transition of the prison. We also remain keen to support other organisations who will be facing a similar transition process in the future as more PFI contracts expire, although I appreciate the Kilmarnock contract is the only PFI to include design, build, operate and finance in Scotland. I hope today I can provide the committee with a greater understanding of the successful transition, and I welcome any questions the committee has.
Thank you very much indeed. Can I just ask an opening question, Director General? Did you say that the Scottish Government's not directly responsible for this process? I mean, you are the accountable officer, aren't you? And your responsibility is to make sure that there is value for money in the outcomes from this process.
Absolutely, we're aware of that. What we're not involved with is the direct management of private finance contracts, and we're not directly involved in the process for decisions around what to do as those contracts come to an end. But we do have an interest and overview in terms of how education and justice bodies are managing that process. And as I say, I'm very grateful for the work that Scottish Futures Trust do in ensuring consistent guidance and support for bodies in managing through that process.
But sorry to repeat myself, but you are the accountable officer responsible for the economy, efficiency and effectiveness, including of these processes and these outcomes, presumably?
That's right, and obviously the operational decisions in terms of the delegated responsibility to local government who operate schools, to the police authority and Scottish Police Service who run the police training centre in that example, and to individual colleges. They obviously have operational decisions and will look at their estate as a whole, so they're responsible for the estate and will consider any PFI contracts in the context of that. But I have an overarching responsibility overlooking, particularly to ensure that those bodies are preparing effectively for the process of the contract coming to an end and managing through that. And then obviously engaging with my finance and infrastructure colleagues within the Scottish Government, looking at any lessons more broadly around PFI and other finance models that we have across the public sector.
OK, thank you for that. I mean, we'll get into a bit more of the detail of that as the morning develops. But I'm going to invite Willie Coffey to open up the questioning this morning. Willie.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to everybody. Firstly, to put on the record, I'd like to say what a fantastic job Serco did at Kilmarnock Prison over the period of the contract, the last 25 years, and particularly recent years under the direction of Craig Thompson. An absolutely fantastic job. And I was happy to be part of that process over many years, and also still a part of the transition process, Convener. But I would firstly like to just get a flavour, Neil, perhaps from yourself to begin with, about the transition process itself. When did we begin the transition process? When do we see it completing? And, of course, to discuss with you a number of issues within the process itself. So if you can maybe give us a little flavour for the committee members initially of the transition process and the key issues and themes that we had to cover during this.
Absolutely, and Theresa and her colleagues will be able to talk in much more detail about how that process was managed, but it was always known that the PFI contract for HMP Glasgow, HMP Kilmarnock would come to an end, and it was known when that would come to an end in March this year. It was also always known that ministers had a view that prisons should be run and managed within the public sector, but even regardless of that, the contract would come to an end in March this year. My understanding that first discussions between the Scottish Futures Trust and SPS started as long ago as 2014-15, and then more detailed discussions happened more recently, going into 2019, and a project team was set up in 2022, and there was a commission of independent consultants to undertake analysis on dilapidation. So that process has been running for a number of years to prepare for the process. There was advice provided to ministers. Ministers first signalled in 2019 the intention for the prison to come back into, or sorry, to come into the public sector, and then a final decision was announced around that, I think, in 2022.
And picking up on the particular issues that we deal with during a transition process, could we roughly, yourself or your colleagues, describe what are the issues that we're currently dealing with? Because there's always an expectation, perhaps, that when a transition is announced, that it can happen overnight, and we know that's not possible. So it would be obliging, I'm sure the committee members would be interested to hear, what are the issues, the main issues that are involved in the transition process? Is it issues about salaries? Is it about conditions? Is it about staffing? Just could you give us a flavour of what you've had to face?
So thank you very much, Mr. Coffey. I think I'll probably hand over to Lorraine, as the project executive has obviously been operating in post since mid-2022. And set up this project structure with a number of key work streams, which covered everything from buildings to staffing to costs, etc. So if I hand over to Lorraine, thanks.
Thank you. Good to see you, Mr. Coffey. I think the easiest way to explain this is we split the project into two phases, the first phase being phase one, which was everything we needed to do to ensure the successful handover and completion of the weekend of the 16th and 17th of March, which was really fundamentally about ensuring that we could welcome the staff who were in the HMP Kilmarnock into the SPS and make sure we had the mechanisms in place to pay them, and make sure that we absolutely kept the operational stability that was in Kilmarnock, and as you referenced yourself, enjoyed for the previous 25 years, and that we kept that. Phase two is mainly about making sure now that we change the operating model and adopt the new operating model that we want to put in place. But as our Chief Executive has touched on, phase one really absolutely touched on every aspect of our organisation and every department. The main themes, as you can imagine, were around the dilapidations and making sure that the building and the asset was returned to us in the way that we envisaged it should be and that the contract set out. Then there was the operational aspects to make sure that from a prison service perspective that the staff knew what was needed and the operating structures were still in place to ensure that operational stability continued. And then another work stream that was huge was around the organisational development and making sure that we welcomed the staff, all the processes, procedures were in place to be able to pay them. Learning and development was understood and we knew what structures and what roles and responsibilities they were going to be undertaking from the 17th of March. So as Teresa had said, we started that work in earnest in June 2022. Work through our project structures in terms of all of the things that needed to be done to get us to that initial weekend, which was very well organised. And I must thank all of my SPS colleagues, my Circle colleagues, KPSL, for their dedication and commitment, because I must say everybody just really did what needed to be done to ensure that our agreed principles were fulfilled.
In terms of staff terms, conditions, salaries and so on, are right through the management structure. Have we managed to achieve that transition almost immediately, or are we still in a process of doing that? Could you explain to the committee why that can't be achieved fairly readily immediately after a transition process to make sure that the new salary structures and so on and so forth are implemented as quickly as possible?
So I'll start on that one and then I'll hand over to Mr. Jobson, who has got more of the detail. But essentially, there are obviously legislative drivers around how TUPE applies and how we obtain information from a private contractor related to our staff group. And we enjoyed a very good relationship with Serco, but nevertheless, not all of the information was available until probably February of this year. And the main priority for us, given that staff need to be paid, was to ensure that our payroll system was set up in order that all staff would continue to be paid at the end of March and on an ongoing basis. there were other things that we also thought were really important around staff initially were put onto the civil service pension scheme. There were things around staff breaks, so staff breaks in the back shift and at weekends weren't in place. And that's not something that we would support as an organisation. We think people should have regular breaks. So the number of things that we put in place immediately, and then other things because we need the information, we need to speak to staff. The two operating models of the private sector and the public sector are quite distinctly different. Private sector works on the basis of a contract arrangement, whereas public sector, obviously, we don't have a contract to work to, we work to key performance indicators. So the two models are quite distinctly different. So we need to better understand, using not just the information that we've had pre-transition, but also from the staff now about the current roles and responsibilities that they've been undertaking, and try and map them to the roles and responsibilities that we understand within the SPS. And that's going to take a little bit of time, but I think there's been some really good discussions with our trade union partners, and there will be ongoing work, but that will take a number of months for us to see through to completion. But Adam, would you like to come in and just say a bit more about that?
Yeah, so I think it's important to note that this was always part of the plan. As Ms. Regan had set out, we had that phase one plan about operational stability. It was about making the changes that we needed to make to work in SPS, but it wasn't about changing everything. It wasn't about our target operating model, as we call it, which we always said was going to be further down the line. And we committed to that harmonisation within 12 months of transfer. So we've always communicated that was our intention. And we've just more recently communicated with the support of the unions that will actually take place on the 1st of December. Now, there's a number of reasons that have been set out to explain that and why we always planned it that way. And don't forget, the legislation is there to protect staff who are transferred under the 2P legislation, that we have to honour their terms and conditions as is. That's not to say that we can't offer them our terms and conditions, and we've always been clear that that's what we want to do, but there's no guarantee that they will accept that, although our feedback from engagement with the staff group is that they much are looking forward to coming over and benefiting from our terms and conditions. I think the points made about the work that needs to take place are also important. There is a process, there is a pathway. There are technical things that we have to make sure we get right. We want to make sure it's a quality impact assess. What does the difference, in terms of gender pay gap? What's the difference between the lowest salary and the highest salary? So all of these things we're looking at now that we obviously do have that pay data that we didn't have in previous years during the planning process. The big difference between our operating model and the Circum operating model is that we've got two tiers of prison officers. And so we're working with unions on how do we offer Serco staff the opportunity to take up either of the posts, depending on their preference, what training will we put in place, what support. But also, because our terms and conditions involve working less hours, breaks, more leave, it doesn't mean that we need to have additional staff to allow for that. And therefore, we're also engaged in a recruitment exercise to get our numbers up to allow us to safely move over to our operating model. And we've recruited 18 prison officers since the handover, and they will have come in on our terms and conditions, as we have to do. And it's this period where we have to accept it's a transitional period. We're really keen that people. We're glad people are keen that they want to come over to our terms and conditions, and we want to get through this process as soon as possible. But we have to do it safely, and we have to stick to that planned approach.
It kind of sounds like perhaps one of the lessons to be learned, perhaps, if I could say that to begin that discussion and negotiation about terms, conditions, to be transferred, all the conditions that you talk about, Adam, a little bit earlier in the process, so that perhaps the staff could look forward to the earliest possible change at the transition point, rather than waiting potentially up to another year. Is that a fair comment, or is it just impossible to bring it?
I think those discussions do take a lot of work, but there's other things we need to do. We need to recruit people, which has been difficult over previous years, although we're having more success currently across Scotland. But also the fact that I don't think we would have ever have set out a plan where we say, okay, well, we will take over this prison. We've got digital, we've got other things that we know we need to change on day one. Oh, and we'll change the whole operating model as well. And then it turns out face, you know, increasing population pressures and so on at the same time. So as much as that's a lot of work that we need to get through, I think we always wanted that smooth rather than kind of big bang change in how we transition Kilmarnock into the SPS operating model.
Okay. Teresa?
If I could just come in. Everybody in prisons works on routines. The staff work on routines, the prisoners work on routines. And so whenever you're making changes, you try and make those changes as slowly as possible, make sure that people are communicated with effectively, they know and understand what's expected of them. And because this is the first transition of this nature, although we did link in with colleagues down in England and Wales and HMPPS to learn and understand from their models, but nevertheless, the priority was about making sure that the prison could still function, that staff were not confused about what the expectations were of them, that they were still familiar with their routines. And as we work through the rest of this year up until the 1st of December, what that gives us is the opportunity to make small incremental changes and make that over a longer period of time to ensure that those changes don't disrupt or undermine the operation of the prison, particularly because we are experiencing significant pressures on population across the estate at the moment.
Okay, and perhaps finally from me, before other colleagues come in, convener, just on overall costs, Neil, perhaps asking Peter as well, when will we know what the final cost of the transition process itself is, in terms of, you know, the value for money argument that the public are probably very keenly interested in, and when will we know what the future costs of operating Kilmarnock in the public sector will be as compared to the private sector? Because the public will always want to be assured that we get value for money in anything that we do.
Theresa and Adam will come in and correct me if I'm wrong, but my understanding is that once that transition phase has been progressed through and we understand what those arrangements will be, hopefully by the end of this year going into 25-26, we will know what the ongoing position is in terms of the operating costs of the prison in the public sector. Is that fair?
Yeah, there are still a number of costs that need to be finalised and worked through. We do have a budget for the prison for this year, I'm happy to write to the committee either later this year, both with the confirmed costs for this year and also then the predictions for future costs, if that would be helpful.
Is there an exit cost associated with this PFI?
What do you mean
cost,
by
just some start? PFI contracts when they come to the end automatically incur an exit cost payment?
No, there is with some others, but not with this one.
Good, great. Glad to hear it. Thanks very much. Thank you. Thanks,
Convener. Oh, okay, thanks a lot. Could I just pick up on Mr. Jobson's answers? Because presumably what you've described means that you've got existing staff who were employed by Circle on certain terms and conditions of employment. You've recruited new people to work at the prison who are on different terms and conditions of employment, specifically fewer hours, more breaks, more annual leave. I mean, presumably that could be a cause for some conflict if existing long-serving staff see that people they're working alongside are getting much better leave arrangements and break arrangements. And so, how are you managing that, both in terms of operationally, if I'm on a shorter working week than somebody else, How do you manage that? But also, how are you managing the potential for conflict between one group of workers and another group of workers?
Shall I come in on the kind of cultural part, and then you can come in on the how people are deployed? So, we recognise that the nature of this, the nature of the the prison coming into the organisation, there is going to be this period, and we've got to be very sensitive to that. I suppose one way of explaining it is that without these new people coming in, we can't move over to our operating model. We can't offer our posts to the staff working there, and then we can't resolve the situation that you've just described. We're not bringing people on detached duty from other prisons with high salaries and supplements and so on to boost the numbers. We're bringing people into the organisation at the start of their prison careers on the lower end of the salary, yes, less hours, but on the lower end of the salary scale, to learn from those people in Kilmarnock, to learn from those people that have been working so well over the years, and then we will transition the whole of the establishment and give everyone the opportunity to come into SPS posts. It's one of those, we can't offer people jobs on circle terms conditions. We don't want to do that. We want to get the numbers up, and we want to do everything else that we've been talking about this morning so that we can get the circle staff over to our terms and conditions.
I think I'm struggling a little bit to understand why you couldn't have got the Serco staff onto those superior terms and conditions at a much earlier point. Why are they having to wait until December?
Could I come in?
Theresa Bettis, yeah.
Thanks very much, Convener. So the issue is that our jobs do not directly match to the job roles that exist in Kilmarnock. So therefore, we have to identify and work through with each individual member of staff what their experience and skill set is, and therefore where they might land, what additional training or support they might require in order to be able to land on the SPS roles and responsibilities. So that's one element, which is an important one, because what we don't want to do is either make staff feel disaffected because they haven't been engaged or involved in the process in terms of which role they end up, because we do have those two distinctive operating roles for staff, what we call C-band roles, which is operations officers, and the D-band roles, which is mainly regimes and residential, and they are quite distinctly different. So there may be some people who would actually prefer, and when we moved to that model, we had the same experience in SPS. There were some people who preferred to be at the operations level and some people who wanted to have more prisoner contact and have those residential and regime type roles. So we have to be sensitive to the wishes of the staff group. And the other thing for me around what you just said there is the point Adam made earlier, is that we actually don't have the capacity. So we will be offering more leave. We will be offering a shorter working week. So therefore, we do need those additional staff in to allow us to move to a different operating model. If we don't have that, then we can't offer that to existing staff.
And convener, SPS colleagues will confirm that we are following the 2P legislation, which doesn't just apply to PFI contracts. It applies more broadly in terms of how staff transfer from one employer to another. So obviously, we have to comply with that.
Yeah. Yeah, I understand that you're not in breach of 2P regulations because you could continue to pay them at the Serco rates and employ them on the Serco terms and conditions. But I think the point of our interest here is, given that these are the people that make the prison work or not work, and how they're treated is quite important. It's really, these are questions about how is that working, and could it be done in a different way? Could it be done in a more accelerated way? Understanding that there are some issues around capacity.
Absolutely, I agree entirely with what you say about the importance of the staff, and that's the culture that SPS follows. Again, SPS colleagues will confirm that there was an extensive process of engagement with staff, including one-to-one engagement with staff in the run-up to the process, so they were aware of how this would be managed.
Okay, I'm going to bring in other members of the committee. I think I'll bring in Jamie Green. I think Graeme Simpson may also have a question around this as well, but. Jamie, I'll bring you.
I'm happy for, I think, given my questions are slightly different.
Okay.
If Graham wants to go first, that's fine.
Mr. Simpson.
Right, thank you very much. It's really to follow on from all that. Can you just remind me, I didn't quite catch it, what's the change that's happening on December the 1st?
On what we are calling harmonisation,
right.
So the staff transitioning into SPS roles with SPS terms and conditions, should they choose to do so, will be completed by the 1st of December. that's the and that was agreed with our trade union partners towards the end of last week and communicated to staff in Kilmarnock this week.
And how many staff have agreed to do that?
We don't know how many staff are. We think the majority. There has been one-to-one conversations with staff that took place between, I think, the end of last year and beginning of this year. But clearly, they need more information about the roles and responsibilities in order to make those informed choices so that they are able to transition and transfer at the level which they feel is commensurate, either with their skill set or with their ambition.
So are you still working out what the new roles might be in order that you can, you know, offer these roles to the existing staff?
So we know what our existing roles are within SPS. What the process is about identifying the roles and responsibilities of the existing staff within CERCO, because they don't operate a similar model, and then map their skill set, experience and their ambition onto our roles and responsibilities.
And is your model compared to CERCO's, is it radically different?
Because yes.
We
operate, private sector and public sector operate quite distinctly different models.
At a very simplistic level, it's just, you know, it's looking after prisoners. But so why, in what way is it so different?
As we said earlier, so the CERCO model is based on prison custody officers, and our model is a two-level prison officer model, which is operations officers and residential and regimes officers. Those areas of work carry different roles and responsibilities, so there are specific training requirements that we have for residential staff around things like case management, trauma-informed practice, etc. So there are different expectations that we place on our staff and different training requirements that would be expected from staff. Now, that's not completely the case, because there are similarities in some of the training. So their staff, CERCO staff, as was previously, would have undertaken training and talked to me and control and restraint in the same way that our staff do. But we don't have the information to understand more fully what other training elements that they would undertake, whilst we have quite clear requirements for our staff in relation to the training that they are expected to undertake, not just as they transition into roles, but also on an annual or three-yearly basis.
What's a residential and regime officer? What do they do?
In our world, a residential officer is someone who works continually in the hall areas and undertakes case management with prisoners. So it's about relationships, it's about supporting them in their rehabilitative journey, it's about making sure that they can access services and supports, and they'll undertake case management with the individuals on an ongoing basis. In terms of regime staff, those are staff who are involved in activity areas and delivering qualifications and training across a range of different areas.
Would it be fair to say that the CERCO staff were more generalists and your staff are more specialists?
I don't think it would be fair to assign. I think, as I said, it's just a different model. The public private sector operate.
But you pay more than CERCO.
Yes.
Right. So ultimately, and you're having to take on more staff.
Yes.
Ultimately, there's going to be an increase in cost. Have you worked out what that is?
So, I think the cost of the contract. The contract commenced in 1997. Prison opened in 1999. And obviously it's been a contract that has spanned 25 years. The costs that we have ascribed to the way the prison will operate this year, so the budget for this year, if you look at the costs of the contract for last year, then yes, it is more than that. But we would have had no option to extend the current contract, and given that the contract was signed off in quite different financial times and circumstances, I don't think it would be fair to ascribe a similar comparator to what the contract might cost this year. We would have had to have re-tendered the contract, and therefore I think the cost would have been considerably higher. But it's difficult to see that because clearly we're not doing that.
No, I'm not talking about re-tendering contracts. I'm just trying to get clear in my own head what the difference in cost is from what you have been paying to what you will pay in terms of staffing.
In terms of the staffing part, I wouldn't be able to give you the cost of the staffing because for the contract, because what we paid was for the full contract.
Ah, okay.
So I can't break down the cost of the contract into what would have been staffing, what would have been running costs, etc.
Okay.
It's just the totality of the actual contract price that we pay on an annual basis.
Okay.
I think it would be useful for the committee if you're able to just to give us the comparison of the overall cost under the old model and the overall running cost under the new model, so we can get an understanding about whether a transfer from a PFI-style contract into an in-house arrangement looks like it's even cost or it's additional cost. And it may vary from situation to situation. I mean, Mr. Rennick's also got responsibility for schools, for example, and so it may be that these issues aren't so acute in other parts of the public sector where these PFI transitions are likely to take place. I've also got just one other issue to raise with you, kind of for the record. Are you saying, Theresa Metcalfe, are you saying that on the 1st of December there will be a big bang and that is when everybody will go over in HMP Kilmarnock to the SPS terms and conditions? Or is there a period of time leading up to the 1st of December where different cohorts will transfer to the new terms and conditions, the new contract?
So
Mr. Jobson. Yeah.
Yeah, so we'll wait for the detail of that. But firstly, as Mrs. Medhurst said earlier, it's an offer to come over to our terms and conditions. So we can't make any assumptions that everyone will, but we are hoping that they will come over to our terms and conditions and they'll take up that post. And on the 1st of December, they will have those terms and conditions. There may be some transition in terms of how people are deployed, training and so on. So it might not be big bang on the 1st of December that everything looks different in terms of the prisoner's day, but their terms and conditions. At the moment, the plan is to move people over collectively on the 1st of December.
On the 1st of December, not by the 1st of December?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much. Deputy Convener.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to our panel. My first question is to Theresa Medhurst, and I appreciate you may not want to answer this, but I'm going to give it a try anyway. Did you want to take ownership of HMP Kilmarnock?
An interesting question, Mr. Green.
There's no right or wrong answer.
I mean, Kilmarnock ran well, as Mr. Coffey indicated earlier, as a public sector prison, bringing Kilmarnock. I'm welcoming Kilmarnock into the public sector and bringing it into the operation of the SPS.
Okay. So, Mr. Rennick, you're next, I'm afraid. So going back to 2022, when I sat in the Justice Committee, the HM Chief Inspector of Prisons, when I asked a similar question about the difference between the privately run prisons and the government run ones, said to me in response that HMP Kilmarnock was the cheapest prison in Scotland to run, and I'm quoting from the official report from that meeting. So I guess my initial question is, was the decision to move it into public ownership a value for money decision against that backdrop, or a policy one, solely a policy one?
Yeah. trying to do this in a number of different elements. So the first element is that there was no option to continue on with the contract as it was. It had a time limit. It came to an end in March this year. We couldn't, the assessment was we could not extend that contract beyond that date. So we didn't have the option of carrying on with that contract at that price. So that was not an option that was available to us. When we had discussions with the SBS around the prison coming into the public sector, one of the factors we were discussing was the benefit of having the prison in the public sector and being able to manage with the rest of the SPS estate. So there were practical benefits of the prison being in the public sector. But we were obviously also aware of ministers' commitment, stated publicly over many years, that they believe that prisons should be owned and operated by the public sector, and that was reflected in the decision that was taken. What we can't do and what we didn't do was look to undertake a full re-tendering process that would have been a significant demand on SPS, a significant cost just in running the process, a significant burden for those that were tendering for it, knowing that there wasn't an intention to continue. Well, in fact, tender a completely new contract for HMP Kilmarnock to be run as a private prison, because obviously key elements of the contract before were around the original construction, and that had obviously come to an end. So there were a range of different factors in there, but it was on the understanding that ministers believed that the right choice was for that prison to come into the public sector and be run as part of the wider public sector estate. Decisions have been taken elsewhere. A number of private prisons in England and Wales have come into the public sector over time for different reasons. So, yeah, that was the context in which we were operating.
Okay, but just to be clear, it wasn't a performance-related issue. There were no issues around the prison in terms of its operations. It was solely a policy decision. I won't use the word political because it's not fair on you, but it certainly was a ministerial decision that they wanted to go in that direction of travel, irrespective of the cost.
I wasn't aware of any performance issues with HMP Kilmarnock, but the contract was coming to an end, and my understanding in the design of the original contract was it was designed to come to an end and that the prison would then be owned by the SPS.
So we obviously have an interest in money as a public audit committee, and I'm still struggling to get my head around any comparison. We don't, I'm yet to see on paper anyway what the prison costs to run on an average year under Serco and what it will cost to run under SPS. And we haven't got that comparison, and I think that's unfortunate. But what we do know in terms of figures is that the average cost per prisoner was around £32,000 per year under Serco's own direction or management. Can you tell me what that number will look like under the SPS? Is it higher or lower?
Obviously, as Theresa May has said, we're still waiting for the final figures around that. I think it's important to say that the cost per prisoner, although there are average cost per prisoners that we publish, those vary across different establishments depending on their size and setup. So there's no single cost per prisoner for individual prisons. And then we obviously have to take account of the fact that there's headquarters support from the SPS to individual prisons that wasn't the case under the private contract. So I think you're right. One of the issues that we will be wanting to look at is how does the cost of HMP Kilmarnock, once it's fully in the public sector, compare with equivalent public sector prisons? And my hope and understanding will be that we'll be in the broadly in the same range as other similar public sector prisons. And if not, that's something that we would discuss jointly with Theresa Medhurst and their colleagues.
Before Theresa Medhurst comes in, did you not do any modelling, though, as a directorate, in terms of what the potential financial impact might be in the public purse? Because, and it's easy to say, well, let's wait and see what it costs. That's the after mop-up. But shouldn't that work have been done before the transfer?
Yeah, there was work undertaken and engagement around what the costs would be during 2024-25, and we factored that into our overall budget decisions and the allocation of the budget to the Scottish Prison Service. So we were aware in broad terms that there were very specific costs associated with the transfer in terms of, you know, over time there was costs in terms of the surveying of the buildings ahead of transfer, legal and other costs that SPS were facing, and we reflected that, but we accepted there had to be a bit of flexibility within that to take account of the transition, and that we know that come 25-26 we'll be in a clearer position of what the ongoing costs are of the prison. And again, to be fair, across PFI contracts, there can be variability as well, because some of those are index-linked, for example, that can impact on the costs over time. So we're constantly having to adjust for that as well.
Thanks very much, Mr Green. I can give you some indicative figures, but I think it's the convener alluded to earlier. What I'll do is I'll write to you and then give you that context as well. So the operating budget that we have allocated for Kilmarnock for this year is £20.13 million. Now, clearly there's some variability because we've still got a number of things to work through, and not least of which, obviously, is around where the final staff costs will lie. We did do a projected forecast of what the circle cost was likely to be, and that came in at £19.1 million. However, what I would caveat that with is that would be for 500 prisoner places. We had been purchasing additional places. There is a mechanism for additional prisoner places to be purchased through the contract, and that brings with it an additional cost. So unlike SPS prisons, there are some additional costs, but we don't have a pricing mechanism for that. So we had taken out the additional 96 places prior to the contract ending, so that was 596, and the cost would have come in at £20.53 million for that. But if we have gone over that, unfortunately, due to the pressure on numbers, but were we to take the maximum number of places, that would increase the cost again up to just over £23 million.
Okay, so we in the last session, you were here, and I won't revisit any of that. We talked quite extensively about the pressures on the prison population. Where is it, HMP Kilmarnock? Ah, it's not one of the ones in the red, is it? Or is it nearing capacity? Do we have any issues there?
So the as I indicated at the last meeting, Mr Green, as you say, the Kilmarnock is sitting at the red, but that's because of the staffing profile. As Adam said earlier, we have had issues with recruitment. We have managed now to recruit additional staff in, but there are still some pressures because of not just the numbers, but the staffing pressures at Kilmarnock.
So you've got more prisoners and fewer staff. That doesn't sound like a good mix.
We've gone over the 596 position. And we are still recruiting into Kilmarnock. It is operating safely and stably, but it is sitting at the red risk at the moment.
Okay. And just finally, I mean, I guess what matters is outcomes. Mm-hmm. You know, the prison isn't a hotel. It's not just about turnover and the amount of people that come through and how much it costs to run it. It's about outcomes. So what analysis has been done as to what benefits may be reaped from the prison being under the control of the SPS rather than Serco? So, for example, what's the staff-to-prisoner ratio before and after the changeover? What are the reoffending rates looking like before and after? What are the rehabilitation rates? What are the drug and contraband figures looking at HMP Kilmarnock versus the average for the rest of the estate? So it's these sort of metrics that I think are useful to see as well, that sort of analysis. Have you done any of that work?
What we have in place for all of our prisons is we have business reviews on an annual basis, well, biannually. And Kilmarnock have recently had their business review. In fact, it was held this week. But the contract definitions, which contained performance measures, are different from the SPS, so they're only just moving into the SPS key performance indicator and business review arrangements that we know and understand. So there will be some statistics that we'll be able to compare and contrast, but I think probably in terms of the detail that you're looking for, we would need to write to you separately with that.
I think that would be helpful, because again, I know we said focus on money, but also it's people as well, and that's important. And I guess my final one was an issue that came up just towards the end of last year. Whilst you're here, you could clarify it. When Serco left the prison, did they take all the body-worn cameras with them, and do the staff there at the moment still have them or not?
There were some systems and services that we have retained. Body-worn cameras was not something that we retained. We have a pilot across three establishments in SPS at the moment, which has got a different model of how we use the body-worn cameras. The body-worn cameras in Kilmarnock were one per hall, and that's not how we're deploying the pilot in SPS sites. So the cameras were quite old, and it wasn't equipment or kit. We are looking at something which is much more modern. What we did do, though, was we did invest in the staff alarm system and
upgrading the blind spots in the radio system that were existing. So there wasn't a working staff alarm system for non-operational staff or those who weren't carrying a radio. So we decided that rather than we wouldn't keep the body-worn cameras because, as Teresa said, a different model to the way of operation that we're looking to move to, we chose to invest in the alarm system for all staff.
So just to get this right, there are people who did have body-worn cameras that no longer have them. But what's been the feedback from the officers about that? Are they happy with that, the removal, or are they upset about it? Do they feel less safe?
We've not had any direct feedback from staff about certainly feeling less safe because of the removal of body-worn cameras. And that was something that we had communicated to them back at the time when that decision was made, quite a number of months before the transfer. And I hadn't heard anything from staff to say that they were overtly concerned about the removal of the body-worn cameras, when we did say that we were upgrading the other systems and fixing some of the known blind spots with the radio system.
I mean, you can't go to the supermarket without being greeted by somebody with a body-worn camera. It seems odd that our prison staff don't have them.
We are piloting body-worn cameras just now, as I say, Mr Green, across three sites. And once the evaluation has been completed, then we'll look at what the implications are across all SPS prisons.
Okay, thank you for the update. I'll come back in later with some PFI questions.
Yeah. Thank you very much. We're kind of moving into the second half of this morning's session. So, Mr. Riki, Ms. Alexander, we may come to you with some questions we'd like you to answer. I think my first question, though, is going to be targeted to Mr. Rennick, because, as I understand it, there are eight PFI projects within the Education and Justice Division which are due to end before 2030. And this came up when Willie Coffey was asking you questions in relation to the HMP Kilmarnock. Do any of these contracts have exit fees attached to them?
My understanding is yes, that that three of them have exit fees attached to them.
Okay. And Mr. Riki, in your broader survey of PFI contracts, are you aware of the quantum of PFI contracts that are coming up over the next few years that have got these exit fees?
I do know all of the contracts that are coming to an end, but the exit fees are, some of them are fixed, some of them are negotiable, some of them are based on market prices at the time, so it's not possible to give you an exact figure as to what the exit fees would be across, or the final payment, the bullet payment. They're contractually different in different cases, but it's not possible to give an exact figure for that until all of those contracts have come to an end and they've all been settled.
But do you know how many there are, say, in those contracts that are coming to an end between now and 2030? I don't know, Ms. Alexander, you might be able to help with that.
Certainly, in looking at the expiring PFI contracts in the Audit Scotland list, there are, I think it's nine of those projects which have some form of payment to be either negotiated or capped payment to be made.
Okay. Because, I mean, the BBC, I think, carried a story with the headline, buyback deals to cost taxpayer millions. And I think they referred to 11 PFI contracts. You think the figure is less? I don't know about the millions, but the number of contracts that that exit fee applies to, you think is 9, Ms. Alexander?
I think just in terms of the Audit Scotland list looking down, there are 9. Okay. There may be some associated SFT's focus is on the accommodation projects. We don't look at the Scottish Water and Scottish Transport, so it may be that there's a cut-off line somewhere there, which means that number is 11 rather than 9, but that was just having a quick look down the list that I know the committee has been provided with in advance of today.
Thanks, that's helpful. And can we just clarify what purpose is served by an exit fee? Why is there an exit? You know, we've learned this morning there wasn't one in the case of Kilmarnock Prison. Why on some contracts are there exit fees, and you know, why would you negotiate an exit fee?
It very much relates to those very early projects, and at the time for some of those really early projects, to make sure the risk transfer worked, so the technical rules at the time to enable the risk transfer to the private sector meant that the public body would grant a lease, often it was through a lease structure, a very long-term lease, sometimes a 100-year type lease, and then the private sector would create a sublease to allow the services to take place, and the education services or health services. And so what was required as part of the contract then was that the public sector had the option to either, the public sector could either walk away from the lease or they could buy out the lease structure. And because those kind of mechanisms, which meant they had to have that buyout payment, that was why it's kind of been negotiated as either a residual value payment or it could be valued on the state of the market. There are a number of different ways of calculating it. So that's how they kind of came about, and they're not on the later ones because the requirements for risk transfer meant that fell away, and the land is owned and stays in the ownership of the public sector throughout the duration of the contract.
But again, I'm struggling a little bit to understand under what circumstances the public sector would walk away from a lease. You know, if you've got a new hospital which is 25 years old, you're not going to abandon it. I suppose there may be circumstances where you might do, but I mean, it's highly unlikely, isn't it? Because in comparative terms, it's still going to be a fairly relatively new piece of building. Of infrastructure, building, part of the health mm-hmm. service, for example. I'm struggling a little bit to understand, under those circumstances, why walking away would be considered an option, and secondly, therefore, why there is this exit fee premium that's required to be paid.
I think that's a really sensible point to make in terms of what were the what was the situation at the time to enable those contracts to be transferred to the private sector. And this was the mechanism that was in place to do that. And because you're right, in the vast majority of cases, it is likely that, especially if it's a school service or a health service, that will continue on. There could be examples where if it was a small accommodation building and that was no longer needed or was part of a health disposal strategy. So that may have been the case, but you're right, on the whole, that was the... You would anticipate that they would be ongoing. But as I say, that was a practice that was there in the very early stages of PFI and those early stage development, and has since stopped.
And the competitive pressure at the time, everybody knew that was bidding for those projects 25 years ago, that the structure was a payment through the life of the contract and a payment at the end. So the competitive tension at the time would have caused bidders to consider whether they wanted to lower their price for the 25 years based on getting something in the end. And we don't know what views bidders took, i.e. how much higher the price would have been over the 25 years had there not been the additional payment at the end, because that was a competitive process back then. So that structure was needed, as Kerry said, to deliver the additionality under the accounting rules at the time to transfer that risk. And as to exactly what financial arrangements bidders made based on that tendering opportunity that they were given, it was a matter for them at the time. But it would have been assessed, the total cost to the public authority when that procurement would have been made was based on assessment of those different elements of the cost.
Okay. One of the other kind of variables on these contracts is that some, I think, have got so-called secondary periods, which is, as I understand it, a kind of an extension of the PFI contract. Again, I don't know whether Ms. Alexander or Mr. Rieke, you can tell us what your understanding is of how many of those there are in the system, or that we're likely to face again between now and 2030, for example.
I don't have the exact number of which do have secondary periods. That could be something we could follow up on. I know there are a small number of those within the list as well. If we need further information on those,
that's helpful. I mean, I'm conscious of the fact that Mr. Rieke told us last time he was here that there are only three people in the team looking at PFI. So I recognise there might be some capacity issues. But yeah, if you could supply us with that information, that would be very helpful for us. And in a kind of similar vein, is re-tendering an option in any of these cases? I mean, that's probably more a question for Mr. Rennick. But is re-tendering a consideration? Do you look at a range of options in the lead up to the expiry of one of these PFI contracts, which includes, we kind of rehearsed it a little bit with the Serco contract at Kilmarnock, but in more general terms, is that a consideration? Wearing your value for money hat, for example?
Yeah, in terms of any of these contracts, the contracting authority will be aware that the contract is due to come to an end, and will be considering a range of different options of how to take that forward and how to act beyond the end of the current contract. And we know for those that are most imminent that process is being gone through to look at that. And again, subject to anything SFT colleagues say, there would be, clearly it couldn't be the same contract, because the contract for the construction and the management and maintenance has come to an end. It would be perfectly open for a public body to consider, for example, having a private contract for the maintenance of an asset. I think part of the consideration would be where that fits within their wider management of their estate as a whole. So, for example, for schools, how that fits within the overall management of schools within a local authority area, or similarly for colleges as well. So one of the considerations would be whether or not a private contract actually fits and is helpful in terms of how they manage their overall estate.
But again, to revisit a question we asked earlier, is it a policy position of the Scottish Government that on expiry of these PFI contracts, they will all transfer into the public sector?
I'm not aware that that's a policy decision. It's important to say that the Scottish Ministers are not the contracting authority for, other than the prisons, are not the contracting authority for the vast majority of the PFI contracts that sit within the education and justice interest. It's the individual bodies that are, and they will take the decision in terms of how to manage their estate, including any PFI contracts that are coming to an end. So what is our policy is that we would want those bodies to be seeking advice and to be learning lessons. And as I said at the beginning, I'm really grateful for what the SFT do in terms of ensuring that advice is available. But then the bodies are also drawing on other advice, legal advice, contractual advice, and other private advice as well, and looking at it as part of their overall operational responsibilities.
But can I explore that dynamic a little bit more, in particular your relationship with the Minister or the Cabinet Secretary, for example? Because we're the Public Audit Committee, and we're interested in things like written authorities being sought by civil servants from ministers, and we had one last year over the decision to continue with the procurement of the Glen Rosa, now called then Vessel 802, from FMPG. And the only one in recent memory before that took us all the way back to 2007. And that was a decision by the Justice Secretary at the time not to proceed with the construction of Low Moss Prison using PFI. And presumably the civil service advice was against that, and it required a written authority to be issued. Is there any possibility of those conversations, those outcomes being reached as the PFI contracts expire?
Just to say that Low Moss was before even my time.
Before mine as well, Mr. Rennick, but these are instructive lessons from history.
And it's an important thing to say that, obviously, because the Scottish Prison Service is an agency, then legal responsibility rests with Scottish ministers in terms of those contracts and those decisions. So that is distinct from other PFI contracts where the contracting authority is separate from Scottish ministers, whether that's a local authority or a college, for example. So there'll be different involvement and different role in terms of the civil service within that process. But clearly we take an overview in terms of ensuring that public bodies as a whole are looking for value for money. And so, for example, for the colleges, I know that the Scottish Funding Council is engaging with those colleges that have private finance or MPD contracts around the process that they follow through for that, and engaging with Ayrshire College in terms of their plans around the Kilwinning campus that's due to have its contract end in the next year or so.
But you mentioned East Ayrshire, and I'm bound to go into with a broader point about the East Ayrshire Community Hospital. Because the then First Minister, Nicola Sturgeon, announced that was going to be taken back into NHS Ayrshire and Arran earlier than the time scheduled through the PFI contract. And I think there's been an estimate of what additional cost that was. I mean, would that not, if that was in your department, Mr. Rennick, would that not involve a conversation between the Minister, in that case the First Minister, and you as the accountable officer about whether that was the right decision or not?
I'm aware that over time a very small number of PFI contracts have ended early, both here in Scotland and in England as well. If there were financial implications for the portfolio, then yes, that would involve a conversation around how we manage that and what the implications of that are and what the reasoning is for that decision as well. So it would be considered. It's certainly not come up as an issue in my time at all. Obviously, we have looked over time, for example, at HMP Addiewell, which is quite an expensive contract, but never at the stage where it would have been considered to buy that contract out, for example. But if that had been the case, then there would have been a thorough process to look at the financial implications of that.
OK, I've got a couple of final questions for predominantly Mr. Rieke and Ms. Alexander. Just on the capacity that the Scottish Futures Trust has got. I mean, are you able to lend the kind of extent of advice that you would like to do? And what form is that advice? You know, you're in a sense a kind of investment arm. What advice are you giving to Mr. Rennick and other Director Generals about how they should approach in other parts of the public sector, people like Ms. Meadows? What advice are you giving them? What does that cover?
Well, I suppose overall our role is to support those authorities to deliver the best outcomes, including financial outcomes, as these contracts come to an end. And we have a small team, as you've said already, who provide a commercial support by drawing together the authorities, first of all, to help them form communities of interest, people that are doing the same thing, because sometimes if you're doing one thing in one council, you're not so joined up with the person in the next council up that's doing the same sorts of thing. So we help them share the knowledge that way. And we've provided some specific support on particularly complex generic issues. So in the past, around refinancing of PFI contracts, which you'll be aware comes up from time to time, where our sort of commercial background allows us to help with some of the considerations around that. And then in the handback program in particular, we've got a program of activities providing advice and guidance, which Kerry can talk through.
Yes, so we would typically, we have a collaboration handback network to which we invite anybody who's got a project that's coming up to expiry within the next 5 and up to 8 years, because really for some of the hospital type projects you need to be looking earlier than 5 years. So we do invite people along to that meets quarterly. It's a peer-to-peer forum so they can hear from each other. So Lorraine, for example, has been along to one of those, and I'm sure everyone would love to hear more from Lorraine at a future date. So that type of forum, and also just, I guess, getting in early and just going through a set of kind of key questions on, around the areas that we would see as conditions for success. So what are you thinking about your governance and leadership around it? What do you understand of your asset and of your contract? How have you considered the future service that you're going to deliver from this asset at the end? Is it the same? And clearly we've talked a lot about Kilmarnock Prison, and that's a very specialist case in terms of the operational services. There's very little of that across the rest of the, certainly the accommodation state that we're looking at. So sharing materials, sharing typical risk registers and project plans that people can adopt. But I guess and doing that and setting people up and giving them the tools so that public bodies can then take that on. And I suppose one other point just to make around all of that is we've talked a little bit about the SFT team, but in the health sector, we're one half of a larger team that's NHS Assure colleagues as well, who are focused specifically and have their own end of contract manager, for example. So within health, we do our work, the kind of work that I've talked about, but alongside NHS Assure.
Okay, thank you. And my final question is just to ask, in your kind of horizon scanning, do you have any information you could share with us about when you expect there to be a particular surge in the number of these PFI contracts coming towards their expiry dates, and are you confident that we've got the capacity to be able to deal with any years where there's a particularly high volume coming through?
So it's really the latter half of the 2020s, mm-hmm. Towards the end of the 2020s, is quite a big peak of activity. So last year and this year, bearing in mind that sort of 5 years out, is where we've been really helping people gear up for that peak of activity. We expect to continue to the work that we're doing, but the individual authorities are planning, in some cases, different resource profiles over that period of time. So there will be a need for people with these sorts of skills, and that peaks at those points. So, for example, we've worked with NHS Highland and the Highland Council to share a project management, to help them put in place arrangements to share a project management resource that can span across two contracts and bring those learnings. So there are ways that we can make the best of the resource we've got. So Kerry mentioned the collaborative networks by providing templates and guidance that allows people to work effectively and efficiently. But it's undoubtedly the case that over this period, authorities will be having to build up their teams, and we're seeing them do that. We'll try and help them do that as best we can and get the right people in place to get the best value from these contracts, but there will be more resource needed.
Thank you. Just a final question for Mr. Renning. I mean, in terms of the scale of all this, so I think the total value of these contracts is £9 billion, and around half of the value of that is in schools, isn't it, which is your responsibility. Yes. So do you have any kind of sense of when the demands are going to be greatest on the capacity of that part of the public sector you've got oversight of?
Yeah, and we're aware of, and the Scottish Government and the UK Government publish information on all of the PFI and MPD contracts, so we know exactly when each of them is due to come to an end over the next few years and stretched out all the way through into the 2040s. So it is spread out over time. There's obviously a distinction between the NHS projects and the ones in education and justice, which tend to be spread out across different organisations. So it's individual local authorities that are managing it. So the responsibility is spread across different bodies who are managing that. I'm very conscious that SFT and the pressure that's on them to provide that guidance. Part of the hope is obviously that as we pass through this process, and for example, as more schools go through the process of coming to the end of a PFI contract, then that lessons learned will be able to apply to other schools as well, and that knowledge will be able to be shared more widely. I think the maximum we have over the next few years is 3 schools projects and 1 Police Scotland project all in 1 year in 26-27. So that's the kind of peak in terms of numbers that we're aware of. But as I say, that is spread across different bodies, and each of those bodies have in place their own teams to manage that process and draw on the guidance at SFT as well as other sources of guidance as well. And we know, for example, that they are speaking to other bodies, not just here in Scotland, but elsewhere, that have been through this process before as well.
OK, thank you. I'm conscious of the time, and I know that I've got 2 other members of the committee that want to come in with some questions. So I'm going to turn to the deputy convener, first of all, and I'll bring Mr Simpson in.
I'll shrink this into 2 questions. The first, Mr Rennick, is you'll obviously be aware of the constraints on the government's capital investment. There are a number of infrastructure projects which have been paused, and there'll be no investment. Now, much of that will relate to your portfolio, so new schools and prisons, for example, are a very direct consequence of that decision, but other portfolios will feel the same across the health sector, housing, etc., and so on. So, in that scenario where the government is saying, look, we haven't got the cash to build this stuff up front, is there now perhaps an opportunity or an expectation that a shift to a different financing model will be inevitable? In other words, the private sector will stump up the cash up front and the government will simply pay them back over a very long period of time, which I appreciate might not be the political thing to do in terms of ministerial's direction of travel. However, from a monetary point of view or a value for money point of view, is that not something that should be considered?
In terms specifically of schools and prisons, which you mentioned, obviously, in terms of the prisons estate, Scottish ministers have already committed to the construction of HMP Highland, and we're awaiting the final business case on HMP Glasgow. But both of those have been proceeding. Highland is proceeding, and HMP Glasgow has been proceeding using traditional capital funding from the Scottish Government, and that's the approach in terms of the prisons that are in the pipeline just now. In terms of schools, as you'll be aware, we've had a 2 separate programmes that we've followed in terms of Schools for the Future, and then the Learning Estate Improvement Programme that we've had more recently. Just a number of months ago, I think it was towards the end of last year, we confirmed phase 3 of the LEAP that will, once it's completed, deliver a further 47 schools projects. So that has been progress through an outcome-based model where the local authority builds the school and the Scottish Government provides a revenue stream on an ongoing basis for particular outcomes in terms of maintenance and net zero and the running of the schools. So we have models in place already in terms of schools and prisons. Overall, across the Scottish Government as a whole, you are right that the projection, and it was reflected in the budget, is that our capital budget is likely to be constrained over the coming years. Ministers have said that they are open to looking at other models, including the MIM, which I can't off the top of my head remember what that stands for, but the MIM model, which is a form of mutual investment model for... which would allow finance, and that is being considered, as I understand ministers have indicated, although not confirmed, it's been considered as an option for the A9 dualling. So ministers are clear that there are those models available. Obviously, we are facing pressures anyway on our capital budgets because of inflation and other pressures just now. So it is becoming more challenging to take forward our capital plans. And we've indicated, or ministers have indicated, that we're reviewing our forward plans for capital investment. And later in the year, there will be an update on that linking into the budget process.
I think that kind of gets to the nub of my question, though, is that, where when times are good, and there's money in the bank, the government can easily make a decision to say, look, we've got the cash, we'd rather fund this stuff directly from government, either through government borrowing or through capital that we have in reserve. And we want to try and avoid and minimise where possible private investment, because obviously there are repayments and interest and there's a cost associated with that. And it's just not the direction of travel we want to take in. But as you've just outlined, we're in very different times now. Restraints on capital investment mean that there's less money to go around. Now, in that scenario, if, for example, I came and knocked on your door tomorrow and said, I'm happy to build a replacement for HMP Greenock or Dumfries, both in desperate need of replacement, I should add, would there be an open door to say, look, there's models out there, there may be a deal to be done? Or is it just simply, no, the government want to only spend what they've got?
As it currently stands, the project that's sit within, obviously, my sit is over the education and justice portfolio projects. The major capital projects that we have are the two prisons and the Dunfermline campus.
Example of new investment, new money, new build, and the model that might accompany that scenario.
That hasn't been discussed with that hasn't been discussed with ministers at this stage.
Okay.
But obviously, part of the review of our capital plans will not just be looking at what those capital plans are, but how they will be financed going forward.
Okay, we look forward to that. And the second question is simply around PFI contracts. I think there's still a bit more digging to be done. I think other members might do that. But I'm still a bit confused as to how many are coming to an end in the next couple of years and what the cost to the public purse of that will be. Nonetheless, we'll come maybe revisit that before we end the session. But is your expectation that these will come to a natural end of contract, or are ministers mooting to you that there may be early contract termination on some of them? Because there is a difference, and I presume there's a cost.
I'm only aware of the education and justice areas. I'm not aware of any ones where there's any proposal to end the contracts early. And we do know exactly when they are due to come to an end, phased over the coming years.
So natural termination is, at least in your directorate, is the direction of travel?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Camille.
Thanks very much indeed. I mean, so there was an announcement recently about Falkirk schools, but by Falkirk Council, presumably. I mean, is that a proposal to bring those in-house earlier than the expiry date of the PFI?
I'd need to double-check. My understanding was that was around them coming into the public sector at the point when the current contract is due to end.
Okay.
During 25-6,
okay.
Not early.
Okay, that's fine. Graeme Simpson.
Thank you very much, Convener. Mr. Rennick, what will be the cost of bringing the Police Scotland College in East Kilbride back into the public sector?
My understanding is that Police Scotland have a programme team that are looking at that. They are looking at a range of different options around what to do with the Jackton Training Centre, and clearly the cost will depend on the option that's taken around that. So I think it's 26, 27 when that's due to come back in, so that process is still being gone through in terms of looking at that. So there isn't a figure, as far as I'm aware, there isn't a figure yet of what that will be. As I understand it, again, I'll triple check, but as I understand it, there is a payment that's related to the Jackton Centre that would have to be made.
But is it? Are we talking millions?
Let me just double check if I've got it in my notes. Yeah, I'll need to double check whether that's in the public domain, but there is a figure in the low millions related
millions
to
of pounds.
Yeah.
Okay. So, and I think this question applies to all these contracts then that are due to end and which have a payback attached to them. What happens if there's no agreement? If the public sector just says, well, that's far too much, we can't afford it, go away.
There will be, again, SFT colleagues may want to come in, but my assumption is that will be set out in the contract, what happens and what the requirements are within those circumstances specific to each contract. Again, as I understand it just now, in terms of Kilmarnock and in terms of those others, projects that are due to come back into the public sector, that there's been positive discussions with the contractor through that, and that engagement is happening. Again, SFT colleagues will be able to confirm that.
Mr. Rickey, do you know the answer?
Well, the all the contracts are different, so I'm not going to go down a big list. I don't know all the detail of them all, but the generality is that the contract requires the parties to come together and negotiate the position. Many of them will have an arrangement whereby the public authority is entitled, as we said before, to simply walk away and not use the asset and leave that asset on its remaining long lease with the private sector partner for the ones that have that extended lease period. But what will happen in practice is that the parties will come together under all of the arrangements that we've been talking about, and if it's subject to negotiation, negotiate it, or if it's a figure in the contract, decide whether or not to pay it.
I'm afraid that's very simplistic. You know, let's take that police college in East Kilbride.
Yeah.
If Police Scotland are being expected to pay millions of pounds at the end of that contract, and Police Scotland are up against it, I mean, they can't even renew police stations or police cars, there surely is a risk that they can't. Police Scotland will not be able to afford that exit pay or that final payment. So what happens?
My understanding is that the Jackton Training Centre is being looked at as part of the wider estates review of Police Scotland. So they would consider the value of that asset and whether they want to continue with it longer term as part of that wider estates review, as they do for lots of other elements of the police estate as well.
So it could close?
I wouldn't want to speculate. As I understand it, they're looking at a range of different options as to what the best future is in terms of the estate as a whole, which would include their training facilities.
So our advice would always be to start with that. What's the longer-term service need and what's the longer-term asset need that goes with that service need, and then build that into the thinking about what you do at the end of a contract term. But and starting that early is the right thing to do.
Again, I think the important thing to say is this is not a surprise. This was always known as part of the contracts that this was part of and would have been factored in and will be factored into the planning for it.
But this is the risk, isn't it, with these contracts? You know, all sounds good right at the start, but we get to the end and suddenly the financial situation is different. So Police Scotland, as I say, they're not awash with cash. So we could get to that position in 2026-27 where they say, we just can't afford it. We're just going to have to hand this asset back.
To expect for any of the bodies that decision is taken at the point of the ending of the contract. The reporting around Falkirk Council Schools is they're already factoring in within their capital plans what the costs would be of the bringing the schools into the public sector. And I know that the police will be doing the same in terms of the options that they are looking at. So it is being factored in and being planned for that because they are aware of that as part of the planning.
Okay. Convener, I was just looking at the list that you referred to from the BBC of 11 PFI contracts which were due to end, which would require a payment. Six of those were in the health area, so a number of hospitals. We haven't got the expertise here today, but I'm just putting it on the record. I think it would be worth the committee having a delve into those. One of those is in the region that we both represent, which is the
Wishaw.
University Hospital Wishaw, but there are others as well. So I think it might be worth further work. I'm not expecting this panel to answer that, but I'll leave it there.
Okay, well, we do have the Chief Executive of the National Health Service in Scotland coming before the committee before we break for summer recess, so that's maybe something we could consider there. I suppose the parting question would really be around lessons learned, and maybe starting with lessons learned. I know you're still in the middle of the transition, or you haven't completed the transition, Theresa Medhurst and your colleagues. I mean, do you have any sense, even at this early stage, that there are things you might have done differently, or Lorraine Rugan, when you go to Kerry Alexander's collaborative workshops and share your experience. What are the do's and don'ts you would take to that kind of get-together?
I think some of the things that we talked about around the dilapidations mainly was the timing of when we do the final survey. So we knew contractually we had to do it by the anniversary of the final year. Do you do it a little bit earlier and give yourself a bit more time to manage the outcome, but risk the asset then of degrading a little bit and you've missed an opportunity to understand that? Or do you wait till a little bit till the end and you've got more certainty about the asset? But a year sounds like a long time, but in actual fact, it's not to do the survey, share the survey, understand the outcomes, and then actually build in time for the work to be done. So some of the things we shared around with the Handback Forum in April was the negotiated outcome we had in collaboration with the retention allowance that was in our contract. So there is some work on the asset that is being done now post-contract through a legal tripartite agreement between us, KPSL and Serco. And once that's complete, it signals the release of some of the retention, and that's worked very well for us. But that we didn't envisage that at the start of the project. That came by osmosis through the process and has worked really well for us as a group. So there are things that you probably need to consider in terms of timing of some of those large pieces of work and where you might be able to go. And some of the work that we've done was really helpful in some of the replacement of some of the big pieces of assets. One of the other things for us really is the contract is off its time and was very light on anything to do with digital. So not a line. We knew that then there was equipment in place, but there was no real set guidance for us as to how to manage that. So the SPS has invested quite heavily in actually our own digital network within Kilmarnock and replacing some of the equipment that was there and along with some of the changes. But we did that working collaboratively again with KPSL and Serco without the kind of some of the contractual guidance and took some pragmatic decisions around that. But I still think that even although you've planned all of those things, you are transferring everything on one night. You can never get away from that frenzied set of activity that happens over the piece between, for us really, New Year and the middle of March. And if you plan for years, you will still have that, and you need to be resourced and prepared for that. And actually, we had huge organisational support because we took away pretty much everybody in digital services for about 2 weeks, you know, in the run-up, and there was constraints across what might be done by other people elsewhere. So huge concerted team effort that we have to say, phase one, really good piece of work.
Thanks. That's really insightful. I don't know whether anyone else on the panel wants to come in with lessons learned or things that we can take for future examples of PFI expiries.
I just think that point on digital I would extend to information as well. And we've provided some guidance that's gone out to relevant authorities on the different types of information, because whilst the contract might talk about the condition of the asset, the bricks and mortar that you want back, it doesn't really often say much about what information should come with that. So it's a really good learning point. Obviously, the services are much broader in your contract than they are in many others. And the other thing that we're trying to build in is, again, that point there, contracts were of their time. And if the contract specifies the replacement of major plant items, we will be wanting to look at replacing that with something that is fit for a future for that asset to move to net zero. So it's quite a big consideration in these assets, not just replacing something with its equivalent as would have been 25 years ago, but thinking about if that money is going to be spent, how can we spend that well for that asset to be on its journey to net zero at the same time. So information and bringing sort of wider things like net zero into the handback as well.
Could I add one?
Of course, please do.
And I think it was just to reflect on, so for us, when we do our early engagement, we're talking to estate teams and does everyone know where their contract is and what's in it, and talking about survey work. But the big jump is post that early kind of stage of what might you want from your survey into somebody owning, leading, managing, I'm going to make this happen. And I think that's something we've seen work well. So with your appointment into that role in 22, whatever it was, in that last phase, real push and run up, you need somebody who's on it. And I think that's been a good example as well as to how that's worked.
Right, good. Mr. Wright, you want a final word?
Only to thank the committee and Audit Scotland for having raised this issue. I think, as I said at the beginning, it's incredibly timely as we start a very long journey for individual bodies to manage through this process. I think learning lessons from SPS and others is helpful.
Right. Sorry, I think before we finish up, Graeme Simpson's got another question about the mutual investment model.
MIMS. Yes. Yeah. Thanks, convener. I guess this is to you, Mr. Rigi. So the mutual investment model has been mooted as a way of funding part of the A9. Have you managed to have a look at this model? And what do you see as the differences between that and what has gone before?
So we did a report in 2019 that suggested to Scottish Government that if ministers wished to use a model that brings in private finance to deliver additionality of investment that's paid for out of long-term revenue budgets, i.e. what's been known as the different varieties of PPP, if you like, public-private partnership, then the mutual investment model would be the best value version of that to use at the moment. The mutual investment model was developed in Wales. So the Welsh Government were going to adopt the approach that we had used, which was a non-profit distributing model, NPD, as you know. And NPD is a profit-capped form of public-private partnership. They were going to adopt that. And then, as you may recall, from that period in the 20-teens, the then European accounting standards changed so that model with the profit capping was no longer able to deliver the additionality because it would have been brought back in the terms of the day on balance sheet for the public sector. The mutual investment model has been looked over by ONS now and found to still be, in those terms again, off balance sheet and able to deliver that additionality. It's a similar approach, a long-term public-private partnership. It works on a profit-sharing basis where the public sector takes a small proportion of the equity in the project and is therefore able to share in the returns to the project. And that difference between NPD profit capping and the mutual investment model profit sharing is what allows that the MIM model to continue to be used. And as I said, we have recommended that would be an approach that Scottish Government could take. So yes, we have looked at it, and we'd happily forward a link to that report, which is published if you wanted to see it.
But in relation to the A9, which is the only project that I'm aware of, there might be others where this has been suggested. It struck me that what is actually happening is you're getting the private sector to fund part of the road. And then the public sector, i.e. the Scottish Government, pays them so much every year for the use of the road. You could call it a rent-a-road scheme. But what happens at the end of that? Is there still a final payment?
No, there wouldn't be.
No final payment?
No. Similar to the NPD project, right. None of them have a payment at the end. The assets simply...
And it is reliant, of course, on finding a private sector partner who actually wants to take part in this.
Yep.
Right, I'm afraid Graeme Simpson's intervention means everyone else now wants to come back in. I'm going to make the very final question because he started it all, so I'm going to invite Willie Coffey to ask the very last question from this morning's session. Willie.
Richard, thanks very much. Just... The PFI legacy, I mean, the current Scottish Government's saddled with that historical legacy, and the type of ratio of PFI is roughly 5.5 to 1 in terms of the cost to deliver that. Will the MIM model, do we think, offer a better ratio of repayment for the public? Because paying something like 5.5 times the construction, the capital cost of a school or a hospital or whatever it is, we're talking about a prison seems excessive, probably to the public as well. So will the new model, do you think, Peter, bring that ratio down? You mentioned the profit sharing aspect of MIM, so can the public look forward to a better ratio of return really in that kind of investment in the future, do you think?
All of these models include the design, build, finance and maintain of an asset. And in case of the prison, it includes the O as well, the operation of the facility. So the unitary charge that's paid over 25, 30 years is for design, build, finance and maintain. So in a way, it's not really fair to compare that with the cost of just design and build under a capital project, because you need to think about the F and the M as well. In the paper that I've pointed to, we do set out what we expect the ratios will be, but that paper was done with interest rates at the time, and these long-term questions are very sensitive to the interest rates of the day, if you like. So I wouldn't want to speculate on what the total cost of a future design, build, finance and maintain will be because of that sensitivity to the F element. And you'll be aware that after the global financial crisis, there was a sustained period of low interest rates. So the overall cost of the finance over 25 years would be structurally lower than it was for some of the PFI deals that were signed when interest rates were higher. And as to what the interest rates might be in the future, when future deals were signed, I wouldn't be sitting here now if I could speculate on that well.
Okay.
Yes.
Good try. It was a good try.
Yes. And we are in the middle of a general election campaign, Mr. Rickey, so who knows what the future might hold. But look, can I thank very much indeed our witnesses this morning, Adam Jobson, Lorraine Rugan, Theresa Medhurst, Neil Rennick, Peter Rickey and Kerry Alexander. Thank you all for your input. It's been very useful to us. There is going to, I think, be a continuing interest of the Public Audit Committee in this whole area. So I thank you for giving us some of those introductory lessons, but it may be that we'll be going on to future phases of analysis and audit of this, and I'm sure the Auditor General will be taking some notes from this morning's session too. So can I thank you all, and I'll now move the meeting into private session. Thank you.